Hi, my name's Daniel Robinson and I'm a developer for IBM App Connect Enterprise. Today I'm going to show you how you can use a change data capture node to stream changes from a Postgres database. By using the change data capture node, you can extract or subscribe to changes that occur on a given database server without incurring an extra cost in each transaction. The change data capture node is available from App Connect Enterprise version 12.0.10.0. There's quite a lot of configuration steps here on the database side to enable the change data capture node to make a connection and to have the permissions to read or stream the changes from the lookup table or the write ahead log. The implementation varies from one database type to another. So there's a lot to get through. Let's get started with the first thing, which is to install Postgres if it's not already there. I'm on Linux, so I use the DNF package manager to do my installation. Now that it's installed, there is some basic setup. I would advise that you look up the installation process for your own system and or platform, as it will probably be slightly different from what you see here. So that's my database with a basic initialization and running as a service. So now I need to configure the database for my own system and running it in this manner locally, and the rest of it for the change data capture node. So I need to come into this configuration file. I need to come in here and replace the ident for the host under IPv4, and I need to make it MD5 so that it'll accept a username and password as opposed to trying to map to a user that exists on the local machine. The other file I need to edit, if I look for listen addresses here, I need to uncomment that and replace localhost with an asterisk. Now, the changes so far are the changes I needed to get it running with the setup on my system as it is, and not anything to do with the change data capture node. The following changes I'm about to show you are specifically for the change data capture node. We need to look for the write-ahead log level, the WOW level, uncomment that, and change replica to logical. We should also look for max WOW senders and max replication slots. Uncomment both of these. I'm going to set my senders to 4, and I'm going to set my replication slots to 1. Now we've made the changes, we need to restart the service. Next, we should create a database and some test data in a table that we can then use as part of this demonstration. Initially, to log into Postgres, I'm going to use the following command. This is as per the Postgres documentation. If I have a look in here, I've just got a few basic Postgres and template databases here. I want to create a new one, and we will just call it demo. And I will connect to demo. And then you can see we've got no database schemas in here at all, no table schemas. So here I'm going to create a table called pirates. We're going to have an ID column, a name column, power column, and I've set the primary key to be the ID column. If we now have a look here, we can see we've got a schema for a pirates table. So let's create some data to go in said table. So here's some insert SQL statements I prepared earlier. And if we list the table again, we can now see we've got 7 rows with name and a power associated to the pirate. So now we've got some test data. We're nearly ready to actually set the flow up, but we're going to follow the advice not to use the Postgres super user that the database comes with. But we will set up a new user and role, give it some permissions, and then this is what we will use for our ACE message flow, and ultimately the change data capture node in order to connect to and scrape the data. So the first thing we need to do is create a user and role, and this command effectively creates a DBZ user and gives it the role that we're creating. We've got replication, keyword, we've got a login, and then we've set a password to be DBZ123 for ease. So that role is now created. So the next up, we want to grant the create privilege on the demo database to this role. Next, we'll alter the pirates table to be owned by the DBZ user we've just created. It would have been owned by Postgres as the user we were running under when we created it initially. So we'll swap the owner there. And finally, we will grant the DBZ role to the Postgres super user. If I now list the databases, we can see at the top there we've got a demo database and we have some access privileges on the right, including DBZ. That's all looking okay. Now we want to log out from the psql shell because we were logged in as the super user Postgres. And now we want to log in as the DBZ user we just created. psql DBZ minus H and then D for the database name, DBZ123 as configured in the previous step. And there we are, we're connected. We're on the demo table already. We can look, see we've got the pirates there. And everything is so far so good, working. Now that we're connected in as the DBZ user, we can create the publication. So we're going to create publication. I will call it DBZ_pub. Nice and easy. And we're going to create it for the table public.pirates. Note that we've got public.pirates here. This matches our table schema definition. Possibly we don't need the... There we go. So if we list the schema for the pirates table again, we can now see we've got publications set up underneath where it says indexes. Let's quit for a second. Now that we've sorted out the database side of things, we can go and focus on the App Connect enterprise side of things, and we are going to set up our integration server workder. We're going to create a vault. We're going to create some credentials that we can store in the vault. And we also need to tell the server to run using Java 11 instead of the default Java 8. So let's switch window. Here we've got an ace window here. So we're going to want to make sure that we've run the profile. I've already run it, so I'm going to just cancel out and I'll launch the toolkit. Let's have a new workspace, call it demo. Just give that a moment. There we go. So first of all, I will create myself a workder. And very handily, here's a command I had ready from earlier. Now we have a workder, we can create a vault. So here we are, we're going to create the vault, give it a vault key, and give it a workder. Now we have a vault, we can set some credentials. So we've got to create a credential. We're going to call it CDC Postgres. It's a credential type CDC, which takes a username and a password. These are the values we used when we set up our alternative role with the permissions, so we didn't use our Postgres super user. We have the workder there as used in previous commands and the vault key as previously set up. And that appears to have run successfully. So we have a workder, we have a vault, we have a credential in the vault. So the change data capture node requires Java 11 or later. So we need to use our ibmint specify JRE command. We will set the version to 11 and we will give it a workder matching what we've just been creating. There we go. Let's start our integration server because we'll need it running in order to deploy to it. So let's just check we've got the server here, the workder as previously set up and the vault key. So there we go, it's all started. There'll be some messages around not loading resources. This is due to the switch to Java 11 currently a lot of stuff is disabled when running under Java 11. This is a point in time statement, and we look to be improving the support as we move forward. But for now, it doesn't matter about all this stuff, because what we're interested in is the change data capture node, and that is going to be able to run because of this change. But we've got to deploy something first. So let's hop to the toolkit and let's start creating a flow in an app. CDC demo app. I'll click new message flow. I'll call it simple flow. So now we have our canvas. The CDC node is a database type node. So it's here in the database drawer on the palette. So I'll drag him over. I'm going to use a trace node because this allows us to see the information coming out of the change data capture node in a slightly nicer to read format than what we will see from the raw data. So we can see what the raw data actually looks like. We'll use a file output node at the end. So to repeat, the trace node will make it easier to read. The file output node will show you exactly how the data looks coming out of the change data capture node. Just going to wire these together, ins to outs, for the file output. And we'll call this cdc-events.txt. And I'm going to select write directly to the file. That's the file output. Trace node, we'll write to file. We'll grab the directory from the previous node. And we'll call this cdc trace.txt. And for the pattern, we will just output the current timestamp along with the root and the body as shown there. And let's save that. So now the change data capture node. So we've got a policy down here. Now you can click the browse button and get this. I quite like a handy shortcut of double clicking the node. It does a similar thing. I need to create a policy because I don't even have a policy project. My policies, and then we'll call this Postgres. And then I'll double click there. And now you'll see what it's done is it's actually filled in the policy value for me in the basic tab. Now, we've got some dropdowns to help us here. So if we find change data capture in the list, we will then get some templates to help fill in the form. We choose Postgres because that's what we're doing today. So you can see it's filled in the connector class at the top for me. This is a set of jar files that you will need to download directly from Debezium's website. If you're doing a database other than Postgres, then you'll need to get the relevant plugin archives, and I'll show you quickly now. So here I am on the Debezium website. We go to the docs, latest, and then on the left we pick Postgres, and then scroll down on the right to deployment. And then here under step one, download the Debezium Postgres connector plugin archive. Click that, you will then see a download start to happen. Let's go to a terminal. And you can see here at the bottom where I've just downloaded it, I've actually got two copies now. What you need to do is go to your installation of ACE. Go into the server slash CDC directory, and then in here, copy the downloaded tar or zip, depending on your platform, and then unzip or untar in that directory, as you can see here, which has left me with the Debezium connector Postgres, which is all the expanded jar files. With that in place, your change data capture node will be able to capture and stream those changes from the database and send them into your flow. We also need to use the hostname. I left it as the default port for Postgres. Security identity, this is the value we set up when we did the credential. It was CDC Postgres. Make sure you spell this exactly correctly, including capital letters. And then finally, the name of our database. So this was demo. The table was pirates, but the database I created was demo, so that's what that is there. Save the changes. Save those changes. I still have a red X. List of database tables. So whilst most of the configuration of this node is done via policy, we do have to set the table name or names down here dependent on what databases you're using and what the constraints are. We had public.pirates as our database table. Just to remind you, that came from here when we looked at the schema for the table. Make sure you have the public bit there, otherwise it will not work. So now when I save again, we can see we've got no more red marks. So maybe the flow's good to go. Let's connect to my local running server, localhost and default 7600. And we can see we've got a server there with nothing deployed to it. So now I will create a bar file. And I will add the application. And I will add the policy. There you go, everything. And I'll tick the add project source files and build. Now I can deploy my flow. And we can see it's deployed and should be successfully running. So my bar's deployed and it hasn't complained about any misconfiguration, hasn't complained about authentication. There are a lot of things that can go wrong, hence doing a video to try and help you guys get it right. So let's make a connection back to the database. And let's insert another row. So now we can say we've got an eighth row with Robin and Bloom. And if I hop back over here, if we now look through here, well, scroll down to the bottom and we can see our first entry of Luffy at the bottom there. See that we've got before and after. Note there's a lot of information above, which is around the schema. So any schema changes would be shown in the top half of this very large message. Here's the bit we're interested in. And actually, if I click here, we've got Zoro with his three swords, Nami, etc., all the way down to Robin. So it's successfully scraped all the changes made to the database since it was started. What I also just wanted to show you was how we can actually stop the server, make some more changes to the database, and when we start the server back up, we'll see the new additions, but only the new additions because it uses this offset file to remember where it last was. If I go to my server, stop it for a moment, I then can go to the database and let's do a couple of things. So we'll do an update and we will do a drop. We don't want buggy anymore and we'll make Usopp a marksman instead of a liar. If I just show you, we can now see that buggy's gone, Usopp's been updated. If I now go back and start my flow again, so now we've started the flow back up. Let's check to see if we've got any more additions. This time I'm just going to use the events and the trace files to just make sure we see a bit more. Well, yep, lots more events coming out now. Lots and lots of JSON. Much easier to read with the trace file. So here is a delete of something called ID first, buggies delete. And if I scroll up a little bit more, we will see Usopp being turned into a marksman. Previously, he'd been a liar. If we just go up a little bit more, you can see our previous entries, Robin, etc. So everything has been captured in that trace file. There's no duplication because of the offset file, chopper, etc. So that's all I was planning to show you today. Hopefully you're now a bit more confident and more able to have a go at setting up your own change data capture node to flow changes from a Postgres database. Or perhaps you want to try one of the other database types. Thank you for taking the time to watch this video. I hope it proves useful to you.